So it'll probably come as no surprise to you that I'm not actually talking to you right now. Sometime in the past, I was talking in my office at home, and the sound that I made was somehow recorded, and this sound recording was transmitted to your computer or your phone, and you're now playing it back. And so what you're hearing is really just some version of the sound that I originally made that's being reproduced. And so in this lecture, in this video, I want to talk about how this works, how we can take an actual sound and convert it into some form that can be transmitted and that can be played back, and understand how we can play back sounds in a way that they sound very much like the original sound. So the key starting point to understand all of this is this basic idea that all of the information about a sound wave is contained in the time graph for that sound wave at some specific point. So just the displacement versus time for the air in that sound wave. Now, the same graph can also represent many other things. So this same graph might represent the motion of an object as a function of time, or it could represent the electrical current in a wire as a function of time. Or it could represent something physical, like the shape of a groove, the edge of a groove on a piece of vinyl as a function of the distance along the groove. So the idea with recording music and storing it and playing it back, it's all about converting between these various things that that same time graph could mean. You start with a sound wave, and we've already talked about how the pressure variations in this sound wave can cause an object like your eardrum or the membrane in a microphone to vibrate. And so now the time graph represents the motion of your eardrum or of the microphone membrane. And so the next step that we're going to talk about today is how you could convert the motion of something like a membrane in a microphone to an electrical signal, and how you can convert back from an electrical signal to the motion of something else that produces a sound wave. And then we'll talk about how we can take these electrical signals and then convert them into something physical so that the information about the sound can be stored and then played back later. So let's start with our discussion of these devices that convert sound waves to electrical signals and electrical signals back into sound waves. So these are speakers and microphones. And so the first thing we want to understand is how an electrical signal could be like a sound wave, how the time graph for a sound wave could be converted to something that tells us about how electrons are moving around in a wire. So we've already understood how a sound wave has to do with these variations in the density of air, that in a sound wave, molecules are displaced. This leads to regions of higher density, and this leads to higher pressure and forces on surrounding air molecules, and this leads to the propagation of the sound wave. And so our time graph represents the displacement of air versus time at some particular position as the sound wave goes by, the air oscillates. Well, all of these same things can be said about electrons in a wire. So just like air molecules in the air, a conducting wire has lots of electrons distributed through it. And sometimes they could all just be uniformly dense through the wire, and stationary on average. But other times the electrons can move around just like the air molecules in a sound wave. And we might be used to thinking about a current as in a wire as the electrons moving all in one direction together. So that would be like wind when you have all the air molecules moving together in some direction. But we can also have oscillations of the electrons back and forth in a wire, just like we can have oscillations of air molecules. And so there's something very much equivalent to a sound wave that can happen inside the wire. It's a type of alternating current where the electrons go one way and the other. But we can have electrons moving in a complicated way so that the electrical current at any point in the wire might be described by a time graph like this, or really any other time graph. And in particular, we could have the electrical current in a wire have a time graph that's the same as some sound that we're interested in recording or converting to an electrical signal. So that's really what the job of a microphone is. It's to basically take a sound in air and then convert it into an electrical signal, which is basically an electrical current that oscillates back and forth in exactly the same way that the air molecules in the sound wave were oscillating. And a speaker is basically just doing the opposite of that. It's going to take one of these electrical signals and convert it into a sound wave whose displacement versus time graph is the same as the current versus time graph in the electrical signal. Now, you might think all of this is going to require some very complicated electronics that will be difficult to understand, but in fact, it's extremely simple, and you probably already are familiar with the basic physics that allows this to happen. So our starting point is just the physics of magnets. Somewhere around here, I have a couple of magnets to demonstrate. Okay, so here are some magnets. I've got a couple of magnets that are actually smaller magnets stuck together. But the basic thing we want to understand is something that I'm sure you're familiar with, which is that two magnets will attract each other. What you're probably also familiar with is that if you orient one of the magnets in the opposite direction, so if I flip this one around, then the two magnets no longer attract each other. In fact, they start repelling each other. So this magnet on the left is exerting a pushing force on the magnet on the right, and similarly the other way around. Okay, so magnets have an orientation. They have a north side that would point north if you hung the magnet horizontally from a string, and they have a south side. And so if the two magnets here have the same orientation, they attract. If they have the opposite orientation, then they repel each other. So that's idea number one. You're probably familiar with it. The next thing we need to understand is the idea of an electromagnet. So basically, if you have a coil of wire, like I've drawn in the picture, and you send a current through that coil of wire, a steady current, then that coil of wire is going to behave like a magnet. So depending on the direction that the current is flowing through the coil, if it's going this way versus the other way, then that coil of wire is going to behave like a magnet, which is oriented one way or the other way. So in this first case, if we have the current going in this direction, then it's going to attract the north side of this magnet. If we flip the current around and have it go the other way, then that coil of wire is going to repel the north side of our magnet. So depending on the direction of the current, we can either have the magnet attracted and move toward the coil, or repelled and move away from the coil. So this is all the physics we need to understand speakers. Maybe you want to take a minute, pause the video, and see if you can think of a way using these basic components to build a speaker, to build something that would convert an electrical signal with a specific time graph to an actual sound wave with that same time graph. Okay, well, let's talk about it. So the basic idea here is that if we take this wire and connect it up to something that is providing this oscillating electrical signal where the current is sometimes going one way and sometimes going the other way, that's going to create forces on this magnet that are sometimes in one direction, sometimes in the other direction. And so then the magnet will start oscillating, and the pattern of oscillation is going to be just the same as that pattern of current in the wire. So it's going to accurately reflect this electrical signal that we're sending in. And so then what we can do is attach our magnet. So, of course, the oscillating magnet itself will disturb the air and produce some kind of a sound wave. But if we want a bigger sound wave, what we could do is just attach a flat surface, like a disc, to one side of the magnet. And then when the magnet oscillates back and forth in response to the current in the wire, then what we're going to find is that this flat surface is going to oscillate back and forth, pushing on the air and producing a sound wave. So here's a really basic animation of that if I go back and forth between these two slides. Okay, and so the net result of that is that the signal that you send in, the current in the wire, we'll have a particular time graph, and that will lead to a very similar time graph for the motion of our surface, and that will lead to a very similar displacement versus time graph for the air. Okay, and so this device is going to work as a speaker. It's going to basically convert our electrical signal directly into a sound wave with the same time graph. So, this basic idea for the speaker sounds amazingly simple, and you might be wondering if it's, is it really that simple? Could you actually just build something like that and would it work as a speaker? And so, I was on the internet recently and found that many people have actually tried this with very simple materials where you can start with like a paper plate as your speaker membrane. And just a simple magnet and a coil of wire. And so I actually constructed this object here that I'm going to tell you about now.
Okay, so what I have is a stack of little magnets, and I've taped that to a Life cereal box. And then over here, I made a little roll of paper that fits around the magnets, and then I coiled this copper wire around the roll, and we have two loose ends, and that's been glued to a paper plate.
And then we're going to take the paper plate and just put it onto the magnets. Okay, so here's the finished speaker. I've just added these paper supports on the side just to keep the plate balanced. Those are like little paper accordions. And now I've just hooked up the two ends of the wires to these wires that go to my amplifier. And so now it's all connected up. I've got some Beatles on ready to go, and so let's have a listen.
Hey Jude, don't make
So not bad. Okay, so I just want to be completely clear about what you were seeing there. This was my speaker, and there was no other source of the music. All we were doing, sending an electrical signal through these wires, and it was the motion of the paper plate that was producing the sound that you heard, the Hey Jude by the Beatles, was really this paper plate moving back and forth and causing the air to vibrate. So it's pretty remarkable. I almost couldn't believe it when I heard it work. And apparently, Thomas Edison, when he was originally inventing something like that and heard his own voice coming out of a mechanical object, he also was shocked that it worked so well. Okay, so that's how you build a speaker. And I want to talk now about the opposite thing, where you take in a sound wave and produce an electrical signal. And an amazing thing is that this thing right here is also a microphone. So it works in reverse. This is one kind of a microphone called a dynamic microphone. And the construction is exactly the same idea as the speaker itself. Okay, so in this case, instead of sending in an electrical signal and converting it to a sound wave, you just have an incoming sound wave. And so I talk or sing in front of this plate. And then what happens is that the plate will vibrate back and forth in response to the sound wave. That causes the magnet to move relative to the coil. And then there is a physical effect called electromagnetic induction, which says that if you have a magnet moving relative to a coil of wire, then that will induce a current in the coil. Okay, so this is actually the principle behind electric generators. So in a hydroelectric power plant, a water moves a turbine, and that causes a coil to move relative to a magnet. And so that generates the power, that generates the current in the wires. Okay, so the same thing here. The sound wave moves the plate moves the magnet or the coil, and the relative motion of the magnet and the coil causes there to be a current in the wire, an electrical signal in the wire. And that accurately captures the information about the sound wave because when the magnet moves one direction, that pushes the electrons in one direction. And when the magnet moves in the other direction, that pushes the electrons in the other direction. And so it's like the speaker in reverse. This time you send in a sound wave, and what comes out is this electrical signal, this current in the wire that accurately contains the information about that sound wave. Okay, so one interesting thing you could do would be to take two of these setups, and on one side you would input the sound, and then the electrical signal in the wire would be transferred. So if you connect the wires from this one up to the wires for a similar setup, then the electrical current caused by the microphone would then drive the speaker. And so you could talk into one end and hear it in the other end. So that would be a basic telephone that you would construct by connecting up the microphone and the speaker. Now, oftentimes you would want to control the volume of your speaker. Okay, so maybe that simple telephone setup, it wouldn't be loud enough for you to hear well. So, in a lot of these applications, either with a telephone or when you're playing music through a speaker, what you want to do is you take the electrical signal that contains the information about your sound wave, and then you want to have the possibility of making that larger. Okay, so you use what's called an amplifier, and that is basically just a device that takes in the electrical signal and produces an output electrical signal, which is the same shape but a larger amplitude. So it's just kind of stretched in this vertical direction. So you get more current, and that will then cause the speaker to produce a louder sound. So in the next video, I'm going to talk about what we would do if we wanted to maybe not just talk into a microphone and play the sound back right away. What if we want to actually store the sound somehow in order to play it back later?